Greetings to all of you on this Easter Sunday. We welcome you near and far. This celebration that is now on media only for the time being, we hope that you will be blessed in maybe some unexpected way by the celebration of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We have just gone through 40 days of Lent. Do you realize that the 40 days do not count Sundays? Sunday has been reserved throughout history so that on that day we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And of course, on this day, in a very special way, we lift up the song and the words, made like him we will rise. That is our hope. That is our glory. That is the finest gift that we get from God in Jesus Christ. We welcome you to this service of celebration.
Oh, Scripture reading today is Luke 24, verses 1 through 12. But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they came to the tomb, taking the spices that they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they went in, they did not find the body. While they were perplexed about this, suddenly two men in dazzling clothes stood beside them. The women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen. Remember how he told you when he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified and on the third day rise again." Then they remembered his words, and returning from the tomb, they told all this to the 11 and to the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary, the mother of James, and the other women with them who told this to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. But Peter got up and ran to the tomb, stooping and looking in. He saw the linen clothes by themselves. Then he went home, amazed at what had happened.
And on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, this is how the story begins. The day before yesterday, Jesus is dead. Yesterday, the disciples are doing the same thing they were doing when Jesus called them, namely, they are fishing. It was a good deal while it lasted. Now we got to go back to fishing. Today, the women came to take care of the body of Jesus. And then everything changed. Very few details. It was obvious to the writer. He just said, "Christ is risen." Now we come here today believing all of this, and some of us are very skeptical. I get that. No one blames you. But everyone here today wants this to be true. Made like him we will rise. What happened to Jesus will happen to you and me on the day that we give in to the one death that we owe. I like that. Now, do you want some proof of the resurrection? Well, this might be a good time for you to leave this program, or if we are in church, it'd be a good time for you to leave. You don't prove Easter. You get it or you don't get it. It's like a good joke. It is not explained, or you don't get it. Why do I believe it's true? It's because I have seen people dead in this world come alive again, or come alive for the very first time. I visited a young man in jail. The jail there was a hideous place for young men. Lots of yelling, mean place, dirty clothes. His was torn when he came to sit down behind the glass to talk with me. He was there for breaking parole. He was 19 years of age, angry, living with his grandmother because his parents had enough of him. They wouldn't have him. As last resort, he was sent to a rehab camp with very strict rules and boundaries. And then, a year later, suddenly, he appeared in church on Easter. And like the first Easter, I found a young man who was dead to this world, and then suddenly is alive. He had a beautiful suit, a wonderful bow tie, a warm smile. Dr. Wing, you remember me, don't you? Of course I do. I'm all well now. Thanks for seeing me in prison. That meant a lot to me. On that Easter day, 1 year after his disastrous life was thrown away by many people, I saw Easter in his eyes. Ernest Hemingway said, the world breaks everyone, and afterward, many are strong at the broken places. So I'm going to make a couple of points today. First of all, it would be, we are broken, all of us. In what ways are we broken? By the reality of death. We are like Woody Allen, all of us, if we're honest with ourselves, who said, I don't mind dying. I just don't want to be there when it happens. Who of us cannot say the same for ourselves? Death is dangerous territory for us. Fielding's travel guidebook on the world's most dangerous places names the places you never want to go. Like Woody Allen doesn't want to go to death, you know, we should not go to Afghanistan, Colombia, Sierra Leone, Algeria. And today, an update on that book would bring many other places. As a culture, we put death on the list. Don't go there. It was Becker who wrote the book titled The Denial of Death. We are a death-denying culture. We know it is out there. In the back of our mind, we know it is out there at some time in the future. We don't know when, but we don't talk about it. We don't talk about it, and we act as if it doesn't exist. James in the New Testament says, and we need to get this perspective on our life, and trust me, as I enter the fourth quarter of life, I am very conscious of this particular verse daily. We are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. That's all of us. And we're talking about, yeah, you and I, we're talking about average lifespan of 78 years maybe. And back then, Jesus, when he was executed, really lived to a natural lifespan of 33, just like Alexander the Great. We are broken by the reality and denial of the one death that we owe. Also, we are broken by the separation from those that we love. You know, today there are New Age groups, we'll call them, who get together and say, let's make a circle, let's join hands, and let's attempt to communicate with the dead. Fred Craddock, still among my favorite preachers of all time, says of the church, we should be gathering and saying, let's make a circle, join hands, and attempt to communicate with the living. Thomas A. Dorsey was among the best of the gospel musicians. He's a songwriter. The good news was that he was making a lot of good music for a lot of people at different places. Kind of the bad news was he didn't spend a lot of time at home. He didn't spend enough time, he said later on, communicating with his wife, and even left when she was pregnant. He was always on the road. He was holding a revival in St. Louis when a note was handed to him on the piano bench. Your wife has died, and your unborn child, they together. His life was not broken. It was shattered into a million pieces. People of God, we are broken by the reality of death and by the separation from those we love. My second main point is this: we are made strong in the broken places. When we realize that God is at work when nothing appears to change, we are made strong when we finally get that what is not seen in this world is more real than that which is seen. I can tell you that right now, and I still can't get my arms around it. And it is that deep truth that comes from every religious tradition. It was Philip Yancey who said, "After Easter, in one sense, nothing had changed. Death still hung over the lives. You know, one day Lazarus woke up to the fact that he would die again. And Rome still occupied Palestine. That didn't change. The religious authorities still conspired against the Jesus people, and a ton of them were killed later on. Death and evil still reigned as big shadows over all of life itself. But all these gave way to a long, slow undertow of joy. If God could do that with Jesus, what might God have in store for us, both in this world and in the next?" God is always at work when it appears that nothing changes. We're strong in the broken places. Really? Let's check it out with the doctors. Dr. Paul Randles was my great friend, an orthopedic doctor. I asked him, "Paul, is this that was told by the great author, is this true? Do our bones get strong in the broken places?" He thought for a moment. He says, "Yes, in fact, they do. We're made strong in the broken places. Also, when we stop demanding a minimum wage in this world," Robertson Davies wrote The Lyre of Orpheus. He said in that book, "All we ask of God is a kind of spiritual minimum wage. Believers today," he says, are friends of the minimum. God has dreamt of us being friends of the maximum." How? We are friends of the maximum in life by lighting our little candles in a dark world and watching God make it into a 1,500 watt floodlight. That's what God does with the efforts that we can continually say, "Will it make any difference?" Yes, it does. We're strong in the broken places when we hang up our efforts and fall into God's arms. We get stronger. You know, God works like my parents when I was sleeping at concerts. My father was a choral conductor, and so I would go to those, and eventually, oh my gosh, I'd get tired, and I would slump over, and suddenly I would spread across my mother's lap and my grandmother's lap. I think I was 21 years of age at the time. What I just said now is the humorous interlude. You can stop now. Seriously, I was 7 years of age. And after the concert, without me knowing, they'd pick me up, take me to the car, take me home and dress me, put on my pajamas, and I would awake in the morning in my room with great toys everywhere. In death, God picks us up by no effort of our own and lands us in the new life with garments of imperishability. Thomas Dorsey was stunned and finally stumbled to the piano the same day his wife and child died. From his brokenness came these words put to music. Precious Lord, take my hand. Lead me on, let me stand. I am tired. I am weak. I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand. Precious Lord, lead me home. He made music that was and has been a healing gift when our lives are broken like his. Yes, we are strong in the broken places. Even after the world turns you upside down, we find a strength that's hard to describe. In South Carolina, there are loggerhead turtles, big turtles, we're talking big, often weighing over 300 pounds. Barbara Brown Taylor tells of how they oftentimes get into trouble. One morning, she is watching this scene unfold. They often come on the beach when the tide is up, and then they settle down and they get stranded there and they can't get back to the water's edge. So each morning there's a crew of men and women. They come out in jeeps to see if there are any stranded turtles. She watched the whole scene. She watched them come up to one of these turtles. Remember, over 300 pounds. And she watched the crew flip that turtle over on their back. That's certain death. Then they would put a big chain around the turtle and drag it to the water. They would take the chain off and flip the turtle right side up and push it into the water. And Barbara Brown Taylor said, "It is hard to tell whether you are being killed or being saved by the hands that turn your life upside down." How true. There are moments we don't know if we're being killed or we're being saved. Chemotherapy. You don't know if you're being killed or being saved on some days. We don't know if we're being killed or saved when we stand by the grave of a loved one. When everything lovely and gracious and pure in our world seems to fall victim to corruption and evil. When the meek and the peacemakers, pure in heart, get trampled into the dirt rather than be blessed, it appears. When you lose your job right in the middle of a pandemic, after a good review and 17 years of service, when you go to the Alzheimer's unit and visit the faint image of the woman that used to be. When you move into a retirement home, not from choice, but need. When there seems to lie ahead of us nothing but crucifixion and loss. In all of this, you can't tell if you're being killed or being saved by the world that turns you over upside down. When this world is done with its randomness, pain, and reversals, God's voice, I can hear it, God's voice bouncing off the back of an empty tomb. God's hand comes forth not to kill but to save. Is that the time that we can hear off the back of an empty tomb, "Behold, I make all things new"? Is that when we can hear, "You are broken in every place, and I make you strong in the broken places by the power of the risen Christ"? Made like Him we will rise. May there be some moment in your life, some unsuspecting moment, that you are not arguing about that, but like a good joke, you get it. And know that all of God's words in Jesus and before and beyond are trustworthy and they are true. May God bless us on that path. Amen.
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me when my way grows drear, precious Lord, linger near. When my life is almost gone, hear me cry, hear my call, hold my hand, lest I fall. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me
with me. Eternal God, who makes all things new, we come here both feeling that newness and needing that newness in our lives. Some have come here who feel that life is a treadmill that stretches between birth and death, along which we are pulled on a meaningless journey. Some have come here feeling despair over the continued hole in the heart from the loss of one they loved, and pray to wake up one day with relief from that pain, and it does not seem to come. Some have come here with cynicism about the mood of hope, because with loved ones drooping from beds and wheelchairs, they frankly aren't in a hopeful mood. Some have come here who feel defeated by trouble of all kinds. Some have come in darkness amidst the brightness of this day. Now for one moment, we dare to suspend our disbelief and pray that you roll back the stone of our despair. And you called Mary by name that Easter morning. Come and call us by name and give us hope that it's not some cosmic floating generality, but hope that gets specific with our pain and despair. As you lifted the sadness from the hearts of those who were mourning, lift our spirits, we pray. Help us to see the same thing differently. Help us to see your renewing power in those things that appeared totally dead in winter, brought back to marvelous bloom, in those dark and dull things that are exploding in color. Give us a glimpse of your glory, which makes all things new after everything has been lost. Help us to see that the worst thing to happen to us is not the last thing to happen to us. For we pray these things in the name of the one who came and taught disciples by saying, Our Father who is in heaven, holy be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Amen.
Last night I lay asleeping, there came a dream so fair. I stood in old Jerusalem beside the temple there. I heard the children singing, and ever as they sang, methought the voice of angels from heaven an answer. Methought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, lift up your gates and shine by day.
And now, people of God, near and far, may the peace of God that passes all of our understanding, just like the resurrection passes our best understandings, may the power of God's love that holds us in all times and will keep us in all times in this world and the next, may that deep peace that we saw in Jesus Christ be also in you. The Lord is risen. He is risen indeed. Amen.